less than 4 hours today. I put it on Facebook. I'm like, oh, wait, never mind. Sorry. Michael had it sold before I got home. You know, just everything. So excited to be on this side of town and be closer to church. I feel like I'll be able to be more involved. And I guess that's kind of what I wanted to talk about tonight is community. And I really feel like community is more important now than ever, I think, because if we can't stay connected, you know, we share so much when we're here, but when we leave, we need each other just as much when we're not together. And I really feel like, you know, I feel like our body is connecting. There's fellowship and there's things going on, and it gets me excited that people want to spend time chatting after the services. It's later and later when we leave on Sundays and Wednesdays. People want to just talk and spend time together and share what the Lord's doing in their lives. And I feel like it's also starting to brim outside of our church to connect other church bodies with us. You know, we've been going to Ankeny and participating in the prayer rooms up there, and we're connecting with other worship teams around the state. And I have friends in Burlington that started a house of prayer, and they want us to come be part of their prayer burns down there. And so that, and it's a couple I've known since I was in high school. I mean, God is just knitting people together, like-minded people together. And I think that it's so important that we look for those opportunities to work together when we find like-minded people who are hungry for the Lord. And I think that it's going to be so essential in these last days that we know where we can go, and we know who we can call on, and we know who believes what we believe. And so I wanted to share a little bit out of Colossians 3, and the Amplified has such vivid, beautiful language to describe this Christian life and this Christian community. I'm going to start in verse 11. In this new creation, all distinctions vanish. There's no room for, and there can neither be Greek nor Jew, circumcision nor uncircumcised, nor difference between nations, whether alien, barbarians, or Scythians, who are more savage of all, nor slave or free man, but Christ in all, and in all, everything and everywhere, to all men, without distinction of person. Clothe yourselves, therefore, as God's own chosen ones, his own picked representatives, who are purified and holy and well-beloved by God himself, by putting on behavior marked by tender-hearted pity and mercy, kind feeling and lowly opinion of yourselves, gentle ways and patience, which is tireless and long-suffering and has the power to endure whatever comes with good temper. I don't always get an A in that. Be gentle and forbearing with one another, and if one has a difference, a grievance, or a complaint against another, readily pardoning each other, even as the Lord has freely forgiven you, so must you also forgive. Michael and I, that's our theme for 2016, let it go. Let it go. Let it go. And above all these, put on love and enfold yourself in the bond of perfectness, which binds everything together completely in ideal harmony. And let the peace, the soul harmony, which comes from Christ's rule, act as umpire continually in your hearts, deciding and settling with finality all questions that arise in your minds, in that peaceful state to which, as members of Christ's one body, you were also called to live. And be thankful, be appreciative, giving praise to God always. Let the words spoken by Christ the Messiah have its home in your hearts and minds and dwell in you all its richness as you teach and admonish and train one another in all insight and intelligence and wisdom in spiritual things. And as you sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, making melody to God with his grace in your hearts. And whatever you do, no matter what it is, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus and in dependence upon his person, giving praise to God the Father through him. That is such beautiful language to describe our perfectness, our peace, that how the world should see us, that we are unshakable. And I have days where I feel unshakable, where I feel like I'm above the clouds, and I just am so focused on what matters and what doesn't. There's other days where I feel like I'm just blown about, like a leaf in the wind, just blowing to and fro and reacting to everything all around me. But as long as we're turning and putting our focus and our trust back in him, and really, if our hearts are full of his love, his perfect love, it just changes everything. And we can see things as they really are. You know, they say hurting people hurt people, you know, and if we can see past our own hurt feelings to the root of the problem. It's never what it seems. And the eyes of the Spirit can give us wisdom and insight in how to forgive those things that need to be forgiven and see the root of a situation. And I'll tell you, I speak that from personal experience. Michael and I have been in counseling for quite some time, and it's an answer of prayer for years. You know, Michael and I come, and I don't know what else to say other than I'm thankful that that he humbled himself, and that that God has given us a heart for each other and restored our marriage. I mean, God can do things that we can't imagine. If you ask me earlier this summer, I don't know that I would have thought we would be together right now. And I feel really blessed. We're in a place where the stuff doesn't matter as much as who we are and the ministry that God has for our marriage and to be able to bless others. And so, Don't ever give up hope. And, you know, the world doesn't understand sometimes. You know, I've had a lot of people be like, now, Suzanne, are you just being too nice? But I'm telling you, when God does a work, he does a work, yes. You know. And I'm thankful. I'm very thankful. And I'm thankful for my church body who has embraced Michael and has welcomed him in and made him feel like he really is a part of somewhere that was a little scary before. But there's nothing to hide. So this is a safe place in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord. Anybody have any prayer requests or testimonies tonight they'd like to share? Yeah, Myron. Good to see you, by the way. Yeah. Praise the Lord.
This gift has made a difference to
like a sample letter that he could send to his company. And I was thinking, you know, the graft was going to be this big, because that's about the size of my wound. It turned out to be like four little sections. And he just delicately just put it in place, taped it all up. And so Friday I go back, and that's going to be the unveiling. And I'm like, I was thinking of all the prayers and everything, 100%, you know, and I'm like, yeah, this is taking root, we're going for it.
Yes.
You know, and all the other, that all that dark tissue, all that bad tissue is falling out. And
yep.
The pain is pretty much gone. I still have some, last night I was up, I went to bed at 10, and I didn't get to sleep until 5 this morning. And just because I just was getting pain, I don't know whether she wrapped it, the nurse wrapped it inside yesterday or what, but circulation wise and everything. So I get up and I take the ACE off, and I let it breathe a little bit more. And so, anyways, I am so blessed by the prayers and the support of this body and across the country. My friends have Facebooked me and said, you know, you got to hang in there. And Pastor, I thought about you and your healing and your testimony, the walk, you know, because I've never dealt with this kind of pain, restraint. But the Lord said, reminded me that he went to the cross, and before he got to the cross, he was beaten and tattered with a hammer of meat, and then they hung him on the cross, and then they put the crown of thorns on, and he didn't complain like I did. And so I'm thinking, Lord, this one is trash compared to what you've gone through for me.
Mm-hmm.
And that's an example right there.
Amen.
Of him healing.
Yes, amen.
He died so that I could be healed.
Yes.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen. Anyone else this evening? Any testimonies or prayer? Yeah, Mike.
Keep lifting Cindy up. Last couple days have been pretty hard. She's back on oxygen, breathing treatments and stuff. I know there's a lot of harvesting going on, which is polluting the air and stuff like that. And it's trying to take its toll, but she's hanging in there, but she's still standing for total healing. We're standing with her, so keep her lifted up.
Amen. Yeah, Cindy. Yeah, Tim.
I appreciate everybody's prayer for us over the weekend. We went to Chicago. God was with us. I mean, we was the first group to enter in the stadium parking lot, which was, made it easy for us because we could get in there and we could choose a parking spot for the semi. That was good, and I just, thank the Lord for that. And then we was coming back with blew a tire Sunday, and on the trailer. But I thank God for the road guy that came out, because everybody has their gifts, and his was working on the trucks. I mean, he said he didn't know how to drive, but he could fix them. And I said that's all I needed. Somebody fix it, I just want to, be thankful for him. He's a Christian guy, and it's just it's a blessing when you see God work in their lives and use them. And so we just appreciate, having a safe trip.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Any other prayer requests or testimonies tonight? Anybody? All right. Well, let's stand and invite the Lord in tonight. Heavenly Father, we just come before you tonight. We lift up these needs to you, Lord, and we thank you, Lord, for the blessings. We thank you for Myron's healing. We thank you for the restoration of relationships, Lord. We ask you to be with Cindy. We ask you to be with all those who suffer from asthma or from COPD or for those lung issues, Lord. Jesus. Yes, Lord, and we thank you that you watch over us and protect us, Lord. We thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you as you're knitting together. Thank you. As you knit together a body of believers, Lord, a community, Lord. Your church, Lord, inside and outside these walls, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for the community that you're building here at Abundant Life, Lord. as you draw those in from the north and the south and the east and the west who are searching, searching for a safe place to come to hear about you, Lord, to learn more about you, Lord. And we thank you for all those members here tonight, Lord. And all those who can't be with us, Lord, bless them wherever they are with your presence, Lord, with your wisdom and your revelation, Lord. We've come tonight, Lord. We've come to worship you, Lord. We've come to gather together in one mind and one accord, to lift you up and magnify you, Lord, to hear your word tonight, to be transformed in our minds, that you renew our minds tonight, Lord. Open our eyes to see with the spirit eyes that you've given us, to hear the truth, to hear the root of a situation and the conversations that we have, Lord, that we have been blessed to be a blessing to those around us, Lord. And as we pour out, Lord, we thank you that you continue to pour into us. We thank you that you have handpicked each of us to be part of your kingdom, of your community, Lord. Stir up the gifts within us, Lord. Encourage us in our gifts and our callings, Lord, as we come boldly to share, Lord, and to give. And as we enter the season of harvest, Lord, we ask for the multiplication of blessings to flow, Lord. Exponential blessings to flow, Lord, as the harvest comes in. Jesus, have your way in this service tonight, Lord. You are most welcome here. Lord, as we look around, Lord, at this community, Lord, and as we consider the things that you've laid in our hearts, continue to draw those in, Lord. Continue to knit together a network of believers across this city, across this state, and across this nation. For we know that the end is drawing near, Lord, and that we need to have a network of believers, of like-minded people that we can call on, Lord, that we can pray together for, that we can stand with. Reveal our part in that plan, Lord. As we pray about where we can make a difference, Lord, where we can run our race and link together with those around us running beside us, Lord. We press forward, Lord. We press forward into you, Lord, into the more, whatever it is, Lord. But we know that you have more in store for us. We will not be content to just sit and camp where we are, Lord, because this is a journey. This is a race. Every day we wake up and we trust that you are leading us on this great adventure in this world, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you never leave us and you never forsake us. Thank you, Lord, that there are no accidents in a Christian's life. There are no coincidences in a Christian's life. That you lead us and guide our steps, Lord. That you choose the people that will cross our path, Lord. Let us choose to sow good seeds. And let us water the seeds that have been planted. Let us encourage one another in love. And let us share the grace that you have so freely given us with all those around us. And let us boldly proclaim your goodness and your mercy, Lord, to all who will listen. We thank you that you are good. You are good, Lord, and that your mercy endures forever and ever. In Jesus' name, amen. The Lord wants to say something tonight, but it's not for me to say. So if anybody has a word for the Lord, please be bold and share. I know that there's a word here, but it's not for my ears, apparently. So just be sensitive, and if there's something that you feel the Lord prompting you to share, please raise your hand or speak out during the service today, okay? Thank you. All right. Just a reminder that if you brought a cell phone with you, please turn the ringer off or shut it off until the end of the service. And a reminder that on Sunday, the Gideons will be here. They usually do a short presentation, and we take a special offering for the Gideons to support their ministry of spreading the word all around the world. All right, and my favorite night of the month, my pre-birthday Eastern Gate House of Prayer.
Hallelujah.
the Lord was speaking to me this afternoon that this specifically will be a pre-election gathering. A lot of people are whining and crying and saying this and that and everything else like that, but he's the king. He'll always be the king. And us as the body of Christ need to have wisdom on decisions we need to make to have our input on the things we do. But we need to gather and shift the atmosphere of this nation. This will be a pre-election gathering. I heard the Lord, I seen the C with the poll, which is where the high schoolers and junior hires meet once a year around the flagpoles at their schools and pray for their schools and stuff like that. And the Lord was speaking about see you at the altar. When we gather together, we're just going to just go after God. We'll have our time of worship and stuff. And however the Holy Spirit leads, like I said, time after time, no two nights have ever been the same. And it'll be see you at the altar. We're just going to go after God to just see what his heart is and let him use us and those that come, are drawn to come, to speak out, declare things over the atmosphere of this nation to make this change. People can try to make this nation great again, but it's going to take the hand of the Lord to do it, and he always works through his people. So we're going to come, we're going to declare, we're going to claim, and go for it. So See you at the altar.
Praise the Lord.
That is next Friday. All right, let's speak the word tonight. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover.
Hallelujah.
Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
Praise
the Lord. Ron, do you want to come take the offering tonight for us, please?
Brother Michael on the camera. Hallelujah. Expanding his wings. Soaring like an eagle. Hallelujah. Thank you, brother.
Thank you. You unravel me. presence. We know, Lord, that you never leave us or forsake us. We're so grateful, Lord, for your faithfulness, for your goodness, for your love. We bless you tonight, Lord, in Jesus' name. And everybody said, praise the Lord. Amen. Give the Lord a hand. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. God bless you. You may be seated. Thank you, Suzanne, for opening. Thanks, Mike and Suzanne and James. Good job. Praise the Lord. It's good. And I love that last song. Well, kind of the last song, but I know there was a little ad lib or something, whatever you call it. But that's kind of the theme of the message I have for you tonight. It's about the love of God and how it's his desire that we live not in fear, but in peace, and love, and joy, empowered, and confident in the love of God. Praise the Lord. So thank the Lord that he is love. It isn't just an action or a personality trait, but it is his identity. And so I'd like to start at Genesis chapter 15. I'm just going to read three or four scriptures real quick here, and there's literally hundreds of them in here, but I'm just going to just touch on a few just to set the stage, so to speak, for where we're going. So Genesis chapter 15 and verse 1, Mike, whenever you're able to. So after these things, the word of the Lord came unto Abram in a vision, saying, fear not, Abram, I am thy shield and thy exceeding great reward. Praise the Lord. Then Genesis 21, verse 17. That's a scripture. The scripture I just read to you is one that the Lord spoke to me years ago. And when it didn't look like there was any way we were going to be able to survive financially after we had Sally had gotten injured and left her job. In fact, then they wouldn't give her the job back that she had originally. And I'd taken to church and I gave up a job that was a good paying job, and I'm not trying to make a big deal out of that because I was trusting the Lord in the first place, but it was a little hairy, you know what I'm saying? You believe God, but you got to deal with the day-to-day stuff, and it was kind of frightening because we had the bills were established and house payments and sort of things like that on the income that we had for the previous years, and now all of a sudden we didn't have that anymore, but we still had the bills. And so I was praying one time, and the Lord, it was almost like an audible voice. In fact, it might have been if somebody else had been there to testify to it, but it was clear enough to me that he told me that just, I'm your shield and exceeding great reward. So, and he has been, and he's never let me down. He's never not been there. There's been times when it looked like, hey, he's running a little late, but, he's always right on time, praise the Lord, and it's just about trusting him and not being afraid. So God heard the voice of the lad, and the angel of God called to Hagar out of heaven and said unto her, what aileth thee, Hagar? Fear not, for God hath heard the voice of the lad where he is. Praise the Lord. Okay, Luke chapter 8 and verse 50. I'm being a little redundant here, but I just want to show you. It's all through the scripture. Most of you know this. I think there's 365, if I'm not mistaken, fear nots. So one for every day. Don't be afraid. Amen. But when Jesus heard it, he answered him, saying, fear not, believe only, and she shall be made whole. Praise the Lord. Luke 12, verse 32. Fear not, little flock, for it's your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Praise God. Einstein said a lot of things, obviously. one of the things he said was the difference between genius and stupidity is that with stupidity there's no limit. And but he said something else that was even better that I wanted to speak to tonight, and that was it. He said one of the most important questions facing each of us is whether or not the universe is friendly. That sounds funny, but it's the truth. You know, I mean, you look back through history, historically speaking, you'd have to say that people didn't believe that that the universe was friendly. You think of all of the cultures and religions throughout time, the Greeks, the Spartans, they had all of these angry gods they were trying to appease all the time. And it was true with Rome, it's true even with Israel, with the Hebrew religion, that they're always trying to offer another sacrifice, always something. Islam's the same way, works. I'm not saying they're the same religiously speaking, but I'm saying in their effort to appease God out of fear that he will do something harmful to them if they don't give him everything that they think he may be wanting. Amen. So the gods, in that sense, little g, seem to either be indifferent or downright hostile to humanity. In fact, you still hear it today when we talk about acts of God, you know, tornadoes, hurricanes, you know, some earthquakes somewhere, and it's still kind of that mentality still kind of lingers there. So in either case, either indifference or hostility, it looks as though the gods, again, are always looking for or demanding appeasement. There's something that we have to do to get their attention and earn their favor. I mean, it's literally in every culture. The Incans, the Mayans, you go all through it, and it's constant blood sacrifices, human sacrifices, anything for fertility, for for crops, for rain, for childbirth, for anything and everything. Amen. So, Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 12, please. And sometimes when we read the Bible, if we don't have a real clear understanding of God, it seems to be a contradiction. It seems to be contradictions in the Bible. Now, there cannot be, or because God isn't, you know, schizo or dyslexic or anything like that. What he says is what he means, and it's just that our interpretations or our understanding times are flawed, and that causes us to see things they seem to be contradictory when in fact they aren't. And so now, Israel, what doth the Lord thy God require of thee but to fear the Lord thy God, to walk in all his ways, to love him, to serve the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul. Okay? 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 17. Now we're talking about, we read it fear just as a fear of, you know, the boogeyman, or, you know, somebody's going to pop out of the closet or catch you in a dark alley or something. But this is actually reverence is what we're talking about here, not fear to be, you know, scared. So honor all men, love the brotherhood, fear God, and honor the king. So we've had this kind of this idea that somehow we fall into the same thing. So the question, I guess, is should we be afraid of God or not? Now, there's a lot of Christians that are upset with the notion that love, not fear, should characterize our response to God. In a weird way, Christians have actually become comfortable with an unfriendly God who should be feared, not settling for awe or reverence. They live with a fear of the God who keeps them in their place by keeping them distressed or frightened or intimidated. And the truth is, God wants the intimacy of our friendship, not our fears. Isaiah chapter 55, verses 8 and 9. His ways are not our ways. His thoughts are not our thoughts, right? His ways are above ours. My thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. So our God is unlike any God that humans could imagine. He's unlike anything we could have, you know, so you hear people say, secular people a lot of times will say, oh, he's an invention. God is just an invention to deal with people's anxieties. The truth is, if we were going to make up a God, it wouldn't be the God that we're serving.
Right.
We don't have the capacity to do that. We would have made something out like every other culture has ever made, which is constantly working and doing something hope in hopes that we could keep the anger of God suppressed to a place where he's not going to be harmful to us. Amen. But in fact, God operates in a way that is unlike what we even want, for that matter, or what we are ready to receive. Because of that truth, God isn't some projection of our imagination or our wants or our desires. He's just God. He's just who he is. God simply loves humans.
Yes.
He created us for a love relationship with himself. And nothing we can do or not do changes his love for us.
Amen.
The idea of God loving us unconditionally is absolutely radical to any religion. To any kind of religion or any religion that is or has been. Mm-hmm. This God of grace that we're talking about is a complete contrast to the vindictive, capricious, threatening God of other religions. Mm-hmm. God's persistent habit of relating to us with grace is the best news humanity could have ever hoped for. The good news of Christianity is something that we would never have discovered if Jesus hadn't come and shown us the character of God. He offers us something that we could never deserve: forgiveness for our sins and loving us unconditionally. God is different. He's different from anything that we could have ever imagined. What makes grace amazing is that it and it alone can free us from our fears and make us whole and free. See, the only thing that God's love requires is that we surrender to it. And surrendering to his love makes possible freedom from guilt, freedom from effort, freedom from the thought of trying to earn his approval, and freedom to genuinely love God and then other people. That's why God's words to us, fear not, is not a command, it's an invitation.
Come on.
Amen.
Exodus chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. Now, this is a familiar story that we all know, but I just want to use it as a way of kind of express a few things here. So Exodus chapter 3, verse 1 through 6. Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the backside of the desert and came to the mountain of God, even to Horeb. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire. The bush was not consumed. And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush is not burned. And when the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, here am I. And he said, draw not hither, put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground. Moreover, he said, I am the God of thy father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. So the curiosity immediately turns to fear. Now, the problem is confusing fear with awe, as I said before. A lot of Christians think God wants us to feel afraid of him, and that's just absolutely not true. God didn't want Moses to stay away. He wanted him, in fact, he wanted Moses to approach him because he wanted to share his heart with Moses. But he wanted Moses to understand he's holy. There's a price to be paid to be able to come into God's presence. But it's not ours to pay. remember, this is all pre-cross. This is all pre-death, burial, resurrection. And so look at Exodus chapter 3, verses 7 through 9. God wanted intimacy. He wants Moses to come near, or he wouldn't have been in the middle of a burning bush in the middle of a desert. But he had to let Moses know there are some ground rules here, at least at that moment. And so the Lord said, I have surely seen the afflictions of my people which are in Egypt, and have heard the cry by reason of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows. And I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of that land unto a good land, and a large, and a land flowing with milk and honey, unto the place of the Canaanites, and the Hittites, and the Amorites, and the Perizzites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites. Now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel has come unto me, and I have also seen the oppression wherewith the Egyptians oppressed them. So he showed Moses more than a face. We always talk about Moses asked to see his face, and you know, God said, I have to show you my hinder parts. But the truth is, God showed him a face of compassion, something that people hadn't really understood or known of God. That's not a God who wants people to be afraid of it. God wanted Moses to know he's a God of tenderness, who suffers when we suffer, who feels our problems and our struggles and our conditions. And he wants to release us from all that bind us. And Moses begins to feel a little less afraid. Exodus chapter 3, verses 10 and 11. Come now, therefore, and I'll send thee unto Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. And Moses said unto God, who am I that I should go unto Pharaoh, that I should bring forth the children of Israel out of Egypt? So, fear returns because he says, who, me? Immediately, inadequacy, inability, dysfunction, all of the things that every human struggles with. But look at Exodus chapter 3, verse 12. And he said, certainly I will be with thee. This shall be a token unto thee that I have sent thee. When thou hast brought forth the people of Egypt, ye shall serve God upon this mountain. So God doesn't want us to stand back in fear. And in fact, if you read on and you know what happens on the mountain, originally God wanted them to come to the mountain, and then they're all doing their thing down there with the idols and so on and so forth, and then God says, now they can't come. Now I'm unapproachable because of the sin, because of the rebellion, right? But God doesn't want us to stand back in fear. When he desires reverential intimacy, he wants us close enough that we can know his heart, not just know about him, not just be afraid of him, but to be in awe of him, and yet to know him, to actually experience him. Matthew chapter 14, verses 25, I just want to read 25 all the way through 33, Mike. Matthew 14, 25 through 33. The fourth watch of the night, Jesus went unto them walking on the sea, and when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, it's a spirit. And they cried out for fear. But straightway Jesus spake unto them, saying, be of good cheer, it's I. Be not afraid. And Peter answered him and said, Lord, if it be thou, bid me come unto thee on the water. And he said, come. And when Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. But when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid. And beginning to sink, he cried, saying, Lord, save me. And immediately Jesus stretched forth his hand and caught him and said unto him, O thou of little faith, wherefore didst thou doubt? And when they were come into the ship, the wind ceased. Then they that were in the ship came and worshipped him, saying, of a truth, thou art the Son of God. So first Jesus invites intimacy. He invites surrender, right? Come on. Get out of the boat. Trust me, right? And in faith, Peter steps out of the boat and he doesn't sink. Then he gets his eyes off of Jesus and onto the storm. We've all heard these things many, many times. And fear replaces the amazement and the awe. Right? Because he's afraid. He's not trusting in the love of God. He's fearful. And so what happens? He panics. Like any good human would do, right? Verse 31, if you can get back to it, Mike. Immediately Jesus stretched forth his hand and caught him and said unto him, O thou of little faith, wherefore didst thou doubt? So, perfect love overcomes fear. Jesus is the antidote to fear. His love. It's not our believing certain things about him or trying to do what he commands us to do. But it's the love of God that holds the promise of releasing us from bondage, from fear, and from guilt. Jesus comes to us to show us what God is like. God becomes human to meet us where we are and calm our fears. See, the incarnation is simply God reaching out across this great gulf of shame and fear and guilt and saying, I love you, and let's start this relationship all over. The incarnation reveals true love. If it were easy to face our fears, we would have already done it. But we usually try to hide from them. Someone was talking about, there's all kinds of psychobabble we could talk about, but you know, Napoleonic complexes. You got a little short guy that's always blowing on his mouth off and lipping off and picking fights and doing all that. Why? Because he's afraid. Because he's inadequate. He's unsure of himself. He doesn't feel secure. I think Suzanne talked about angry people project anger. Hurt people project anger. Scared people. I've said this a lot of times, but some of the best psychology is in movies. I remember watching Jeremiah Johnson, and they've got these scalps on the horse that they've taken from these Indians, and horses that they got from. And another tribe of Indians ride up, and they're screaming and whooping and hopping and running, riding all around them in circles. And of course, Jeremiah Johnson doesn't speak the language, but one of the guys that's with him does understand. I think they were Crow or whatever they were, but he understood the language. And he says, why is this guy shouting? Because the guy kept yelling. And he said, because he's scared. Because all of the scalps were on his horse. So they assume he's the one that killed all these people and so on and so forth. So, I mean, that's the way it is. You know, people have fears and anxieties, and they project them. And it's hard to have intimacy with anybody if you're afraid.
Right.
It's true.
So you act out of that fear, anger, frustration, whatever. And that's what God comes. He's the best psychoanalyst there is. You don't need to lay on the couch and talk for hours and hours. You just need to embrace the love of God, and it'll set you free.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. You don't have to prove anything. You can be safe and be yourself. You know, little kids, I remember taking grandkids and even kids to different places, like at Christmas time and Santa Claus. But now we got all these clown scares. All of my kids are afraid of clowns. Well, it might have been the stories I used to tell them about the biter,
little bird with yellow bill sitting on my windowsill. I coaxed him in with crumbs of bread, and then I crushed his little head.
Those are bedtime stories. Keep them in bed. They may not go to sleep, but they won't get out of bed. I'm sorry. And all of my kids are relatively stable now, much older. But I'm just saying, little kids, you know, when you take them to the circus and they see the clown, they immediately you feel they got a tighter grip on your hand. Even to Santa Claus, you know, when the kids were little, they were all afraid of Santa Claus. They freaked out, you know. You think it's going to be a big deal. They're going to love Santa Claus. And you take them to see clown, they don't want no part of it. They're not getting on that guy's lap. They're not getting anywhere near him, you know. And they just get this death grip on your hand. And when you pick them up, they relax. Why? Because they feel safe. And that's what God is trying to tell us. He wants to embrace us. And all the fears and the weirdness of this life, he can still those fears. He just, we need the intimacy. We need to feel comfortable getting a good grip on that hand and not letting go. Climbing up into his lap and letting him hold us and let us feel his love. And understand that we're safe in the love of God.
Amen.
So, something has to be different for us to really face what we would otherwise avoid. And that something different is our God and his love. The difference is love.
Amen.
The courage to face the fears of life, the courage to face the fears of death. Courage to face the fears of our inner self. I'm probably the only one that has thoughts that cause me to question my sanity at times. But he helps us to deal with us, with who we really are, not just the thing that's projected, not just the thing that everybody sees, but the thing that's our reality, the things that we struggle with that nobody sees. That nobody understands but him and me, or him and you. It's love. It makes us accepted in the beloved. And it comes from feeling deeply loved. When you, just like a little kid, when they know that they're loved, they're safe. They're comfortable. They're all right, right? And that feeling deeply loved is what assures us that we're safe, even in a world that is totally unsafe.
Mm-hmm.
And we can still feel secure. We're talking about a presidential election. Everybody's got their, you know, their views on that, and that's fine. Everybody should have. I don't care what they are, to be quite honest with you. I've got my own. That's enough to deal with. But the truth is, whoever is the president, as it was already said here tonight, God's still on the throne. And I think we have a civic responsibility and all those kinds of things, that's fine. But the truth is, whoever it is, whoever it's been, whoever it may be down the road, our hope and our trust is in God.
Amen.
And that's what will change a nation.
Yes.
Quicker than any one man or any particular party or groups. It's going to be God and our confidence and our faith in God. Fear not. That's what I'm hearing from the Lord.
Amen.
Over and over and over. Fear not. Thou art my beloved child, in whom I'm well pleased. Amen. Let's just close with this. Luke chapter 12. We'll read 10 verses here, 11 verses actually. Luke 12, 22 through 32. Luke 12, 22 through 32. He said unto his disciples, therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what you shall eat, neither for the body, what you shall put on. The life is more than meat, and the body is more than raiment. Consider the ravens, for they neither sow nor reap, which neither have storehouse nor barn, and God feedeth them. How much more are ye better than the fowls? And which of you, with taking thought, can add to his stature one cubit? If ye then be not able to do that thing which is least, why take ye thought for the rest? Consider the lilies, how they grow. They toil not, they spin not, and yet I say unto you that Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Then God so clothed the grass, which is to die in the field, and tomorrow is cast into the oven. How much more will he clothe you, O ye of little faith? And seek not ye that which ye shall eat, or what ye shall drink, neither be you of a doubtful mind. For all these things do the nations of the world seek after, and your Father knoweth that ye have need of these things. But rather seek ye the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you. Fear not, little flock. For it's your Father. good pleasure to give you the kingdom.
Amen.
I'm just thankful tonight.
Amen.
That I know a God that loves me.
Yeah.
Because of his love, I can be me and be happy about it. They say, praise the Lord. There's nothing to fear. Franklin Roosevelt said, nothing to fear but fear itself. And that's the truth. As long as God is for us, who cares who's against us? Amen?
Right.
Give the Lord a hand. Praise God. Praise God. God bless you. Thank you for being here tonight. Thanks for sharing your testimonies and prayer requests. Go in the love of God. You can't escape it. Praise the Lord.